Enough, thanks. For a while. You can just take... you can just take so much of the heady brew of beauty. Truth. Liberty and life and all the rest of it. Just so much, and then after that, you've got to come down to earth and start fist-fighting the way things are. You know, speaking of the way things are, I remember one time I'm this kid, you know, and I was in first grade. Now, up to that time, life had been just, you know, you just come out of the egg, and you fool around, you scratch, and you sweat. Well, you know, how you are up until the time you enter life, you don't, you're not really, the only criticism you're used to up to that point is a belt in the ear once in a while. That's about the extent of it, you know. And I had just popped out of the egg, and I'm walking around in the sunshine. The rain is coming down on my head. And, you know, you're scrabbling in the dirt, and you're digging worms and stuff, and just living, you're growing, you're festering. It's, you're, you know, like the seed, you're shuffling off those little pods and things. You're putting down a few roots and sending out a few tentative tendrils. That's very nice. Very good. I'll try that again. You're beginning to send out a few tentative tendrils, reaching up to the sky itself, hoping that the great beneficence of nature, Mother Nature, if you please, the sun, the life, the cosmos, all, will warm the cockles of that poor little rootling. Very good. Okay, you got the scene. So I'm in first grade now. I have been able to survive Miss Bundy in the kindergarten there. One thing about Miss Bundy, like most kindergarten teachers of my acquaintance, prided herself on playing the piano. I can remember, for the first 5 years of my life, I thought part of the sound of the piano, any piano, was the sound of a creaking girdle. Miss Bundy would sit there at that revolving seat, you know, that big seat that they have in kindergarten, you know, that revolving chair that they play pianos on, this thing with the spinning. She'd sit there and she'd play Columbia, the Gem of the Ocean, which is a very big tune in our kindergarten. She would play Columbia, the Gem of the Ocean. She also played something about something goes pop. I think it's a weasel that goes pop. I've never known a weasel to pop, but nevertheless, Miss Bundy would play something goes pop, goes the weasel on the piano, and we had a little drum and bugle corps, a kind of Mother Oat Tin band, of which I was a member. I played a very good... I played a Wheatina box for the... very good Wheatina boxes. I'll never forget that. It played a very hot Wheatina box. And the Wheatina box had a neck piece that was put on it by my mother. We were instructed to take a string. If you want to make a Wheatina box drum, it's very simple. You take a Wheatina box after you've done whatever you can do with the Wheatina. I've known guys who've caulked bad windowsills with Wheatina. I've known guys that have made dough balls. I wonder if the Wheatina people know that the Wheatina dough ball is considered one of the finest catfish baits in the entire Midwest. You make a dough ball out of Wheatina, add a little rancid liver juice to it, and man, you have a dough ball that doesn't stop. And so you take the Wheatina box after you're through with it. You be very careful, by the way. Don't tear the top off when you're going to use the Wheatina. Just open up a little bit on the edge there and pour it out. And then after it's through, you glue it back together again. So the Wheatina box is now back whole. And on each end of the Wheatina box, you glue the end of a cord, a string. You put it around the neck, and then you equip yourself with two of the standard wooden clothespins, and you got yourself a Wheatina box. Now, I suggest, of course, I was more of the modern Wheatina box player. I played Wheatina box that was shellacked. I had it shellacked. I got a can of shellac and shellacked this thing, and it made a great sound. And so I would sit there in the band and play my Wheatina box. Next to me is Schwartz playing on a tenpenny nail. Now, the tenpenny nail, you play a tenpenny nail by hanging it on the end of a string, just tying a string around a nail, holding it up, and hitting it repeatedly with another nail. Now, it makes a kind of a clunking sound. And it sounds very good in certain parts of Pop Goes the Weasel. Flick, on the other hand, played a Mother Oat tin. This was basically a rhythmic instrument he played. You take a Mother Oat can, you know, the round kind. You take the top, you put a piece of tape around it so the top doesn't fall off, And if you're very hip, you'll shellac it. Another string around the neck, and you're ready to go. You use a couple of course, Flick, again, he was an extremely avant-garde mother oat can player. He used plastic clothespins. I just didn't like the sound particularly, but he was very hip. He was an early Charlie Parker in his field. And so, yeah, it was a great deal. And I remember making our gigantic debut before the PTA, our band. And, of course, everybody was heavily influenced at that period by guys like Benny Goodman. And we were always agitating with Miss Bundy to play String of Pearls or something like Don't Be That Way. You know, something that really swung. But she stuck strictly to the old classics. We played things like Selections. For example, Matt, if you will please, this was one of our favorite selections. We would play this thing. It goes very good with a jug band. I will play for you. Miss Bundy believed strongly in the classics. Beauty affects man's soul. Just wonderful. Well, Miss Bundy kept after us like that until finally I arrived in first grade. And my band playing days were over until later in the sixth grade when I took up the E-flat tuba under another Miss Bundy. This particular Miss Bundy wore long pants, but it was the same general attitude. We'll go into that later. That was another scene. We won't even discuss that. However, there is the male old lady. And then, of course, there is the female old man. Now, this doesn't have anything to do with the role reversal that we have going on today. Not at all. Very different concept. And, I've known many an elderly lady who was purely old man. She was an old man, literally. And, of course, the reverse is very common, too. So I arrived in first grade, a comparatively, let's put it this way, free-floating individual in the vast mosaic of society. That's like to say I hadn't run into reality yet. Well, reality arrived the second day in first grade, under the guise and in the guise of Miss Mino. Isn't that a fantastic name for a first grade teacher? I mean, it sounds like I invented it, but Miss Mino, you can imagine countless gags, which I will not even go into. Jovial playground gesturies, jocose sayings. Flick was very good at making up things involving Miss Mino's name. As you know, the first grade kids' humor consists largely of wordplay. This persists throughout the entire life of many people who pride themselves. I have never known a punster who had even a remote sense of humor. Not even a remote sense of humor. Terrible. Have you ever heard confirmed punsters like Dr. Bergen Evans? His sense of humor reminds me of an arthritic grasshopper having a Sloan's liniment treatment. You know, that kind of thing. It's non-humor. In fact, I say that punsters are anti-humor. Now, a lot of people are going to say that Shakespeare, Shakespeare was an inventor. Who said Shakespeare was a humorist? You know? And yet, somehow they'll trot out Shakespeare. They say, Shakespeare's a very good punster. So, yeah, that's right. That's right. That's turned many a good man away from Shakespeare, friends, in spite of the fact. Of course, I will also say this about the punster. The punster, it takes a lot more work to work as a punster than it does any other form of humor. Oh, yes. Most good punsters will assume labor at the dredging up an esoteric pun. Is tantamount to wit. It's also tantamount to inspiration. So here I am. I'm in the middle of this whole scene. I've just begun in first grade, and everybody is working on Miss Mino gags right off the bat. And I realized at that point, at the age of whatever it is you're in first grade, how old are you in first grade, Matt? Five? No, I think you're six. You're six in first grade. I think it's five. Well, yes, but you were precocious, Matt. Very precocious. We've got the only 9-year-old engineer in town. So Matt was in first grade considerably earlier than that. Matt's going to be 9 all the way through his life. I have a vague feeling that this is going to be possibly true of Matt. However, here I am. I'm in first grade, see? And Miss Mino is up there, and immediately I am rendered up to this point. And I've been like all the other kids. And there's been, everybody's been pretty even in this world. And suddenly I am rendered hors de combat immediately, and along with about 9 other people who were not very good at puns. I discovered the pun at that point. Everybody's making funny Miss Mino jokes. All I could say was, Miss Mino is a meanie, you know, that kind of very bad scene and all that very awful stuff. And I'd refer to her once in a while as Miss Meanie. Speaking of meanies, this is WOR AM and FM New Yorkie, and it's terrible. Miss Mino looked like Apple Mary. As a matter of fact, she looked like Mary Worth after about 4 hard weekends. She, you know, if you can imagine Mary Worth after she's been hitting the jug for a long time, it's a sad thing to have to relate, but Miss Mino was a classic. I didn't recognize it at this time because I had never in my life, you know, I did not come from a velvet, a lavender, and old lace family. My family just didn't have old ladies like this. Both my grandmothers were harridans of a particular, peculiar sort. They were not, I repeat, not lavender and old lace. My one grandmother was a typical Frau grandma type, you know, the Hausfrau type, the kind, the mother of them all. She's the kind of woman who, when she would walk down the street, would feel motherly towards a fire hydrant. She would walk over and pat it, that grandmother. And anything, yes, she would sit there and look at pictures of dogs and all that kind of stuff. Just want to mother everything. And in fact, she used to come home. I remember her making hot dogs. The big thing at her house was to put on a wash basin full of hot dogs when the entire family would come over there. And she would mother the hot dogs. She would look in there and say, "Oh, look at them. She'd look at the hot dogs, and she would say, "Oh, poor little things, they are splitting their jackets. Oh, yeah," and she would, you know, that kind of stuff. "Here, oh, isn't that, look at the, he have some potato salad. Oh, it's such a sweet little potato salad." That kind of thing, you see. Everything was nice and sweet. But she was not lavender and old lace. Not at all. She had the quickest slap I have ever known an old lady to have. You know, like some grandmothers can lick, just lack out, they crack out like one of these rare Indian snakes. You know the kind of snakes they claim that are quicker than the eye and quicker than lightning? Grandma, my oh boy, and she believed in this. You know, she came from the world where if you pay for your sins, and she believed in immediate payment. And so if you were doing something, and you were always doing something, you know, this is a, you'd get it like that, just a real quick flick right into the eye. It'd go like that. Oh boy, and she had these bony knuckles. You know how some grandmothers have big knuckles from beating rugs and from kneading bread and all that kind of stuff? Boom, and I get this knuckles under the eye like that. She just hit me with the back of the hand, like pow, like that. "Stop that!" Well, you knew. And you stopped. Either that or you went out on the back porch and did it. But you didn't do it in her sight. And so grandmother was the scene. Now, I was used to that kind of grandmother. I was not used to Miss Mino. And so here I am. I'm in about the second or third day in first grade. And we are beginning. We did not do any of this in kindergarten. Now they teach kids differential equations in second, I'd say in their second year, not their second grade. And by the age of 3, most kids today are very, very fluent in conversational French. And by the time they go into first grade, most kids are roughly at the stage where a junior in a technological college was when I was a kid. They really are. I mean, it's a very scary scene. Of course, they have absolutely nothing else to go with it. They have no wisdom. They just have I wonder whether or not in many of these hip schools, do they have courses in snottiness? Do they have a special division, what used to be called the English, creative writing and all that? Do they have a special class in put-down, the put-down as an art form? And do they compare various great put-down artists? They will have 15 minutes of lecture on Lenny Bruce. And there will be a 20-minute... and the required reading, of course, invariably, is the realist. for this new little put-down, the put-down world. And so here I am. I'm, of course, it's a very simple age, very, very different age. And I'm sitting down there, and I'm in first grade. And we are beginning, and I had no knowledge of this. Remember this. This is a new curtain is about to rise in my world, which incidentally still has repercussions to this day. I'm sitting there, and Miss Mino is showing us on the board how to write. She says, "Now, children, you hold the pen or your pencil like so." And she's showing you how to hold the pen. You remember that business? Have you ever gotten over the thing with the pencil which is held like this? with the thing sticking out. Some people hold it beautifully, you know, and they have the big round swing, and most of us sort of squinch up like that, sit there with the thumbs all sticking out and everywhere. So she says, "Now you hold a pen like this. Now, the first thing we are going to do is to make ovals. We are making ovals like this." And she takes her claw, you know, the chalk on the board, those big round eggs that are kind of flopping over. "We are making ovals. Now, you will please, on the lines on your paper, you will make ovals and try to follow the line and don't go beyond the paragraph markings on the side. Don't go past the line." So, all right, making ovals. Making the ovals there. Boy, what a boring, what a drag. You know, can you remember what a drag it was to make ovals and slant lines? I was very good at slant lines. Back and forth up the slant lines, ovals. And so I'm making the ovals, and Miss Mino is now walking up and down the classes. She is walking up and down the aisles, looking over people's shoulders to see how good the ovals are coming. And I'm ovaling away there like mad, saying, and with that, suddenly there is a bony, gnarled talon on my shoulder. It is Miss Mino. She says, "Are you left-handed?" What? You know, what? And it suddenly hit me. I look around, and I am using the other hand. Everybody else is using the other hand. I am using the other hand. Miss Mino says, "Will you please put your pen in your other hand?" Well, I put my pen in my right hand, and I began to make ovals, and they were the lousiest, rotten ovals you ever saw in your life. They were more like deflated squares, and they looked more like pears that had a bad side. You know, I can't, and I'm going like that, see? And I didn't know, you see, that I was left-handed. This is the first knowledge I had of it. Up to this point, you know, kids just grab thing and throw it. Nobody say, "Hey, lefty." None of that. That came later. Up to this point, kids were, you know, very free-swinging things. I had no concept of being left-handed. And Miss Mino said, and I quote Miss Mino now. I am quoting her as best as I can remember it. Throughout all those misty, swirling, vast, miasmic clouds of time and memory, she said this: "If you will learn to write with your right hand, you will avoid a lot of trouble later on." Well, Miss Mino obviously had a devil of a lot more experience in life than I did at that point. I am only now beginning to appreciate Miss Mino's broad view of life. She is telling me many things. If you will only learn to march in step, you will avoid a lot of trouble later on. If you will only learn to laugh at Bob Hope, you will avoid a lot of trouble later on. If you will only learn to get mad at the right things and not laugh at the wrong times, you will avoid a lot of trouble later on. Now, it has never been proven conclusively that a left-hander can't write as well as a right-hander, but he avoids a lot of trouble by learning to write right-handed. So here I am, I'm learning to write right-handed. See, and and it's not easy because I'd say roughly the third row of ovals, I got a bloody nose. Yeah, I'm just telling you the truth. Now, you want to know the truth? You're getting the truth. So I'm about at the third row of ovals, and all of a sudden, doing, down on the paper goes the first drop of my lifeblood that is being expended in the rocky road of existence. Boing! And I'm making the ovals. I'm making the ovals, and I can't make good ovals. And everybody else is making these beautiful... And I'm going... Each oval was made individually at great pain.
you know, and it would squibble out, boing, another drop of blood, doink, doink. Suddenly, I feel the talon on my back again, and Miss Mino says, Jeannie, your nose is bleeding. Why don't you go down to the school doctor? Come, I will take you. Doing, another drop of blood. And she has me by the scruff of the neck, and 5 minutes later, I am down in the nurse's office, and they're pouring cold water on the back of my head. Do you know the profound embarrassment that comes to a kid when something like that happens in class, like you get a nosebleed in the middle of class, and everybody's looking at a nosebleed, and they lead you out, doing, it's going, doing. Somehow that is a sign of some kind of deep structural weakness. Doing, another drop, doing. And finally the doctor says, well, you're all right, you know, they put the washcloth on the back of the neck, you know, the whole scene with the bloody nose, washcloth, and doing, the blood is going on. Finally, my nose has stopped bleeding. And now I am back sitting in class, and my shirt is kind of wet. I'm sitting down there. I am feeling wan and pale. I'm feeling also a little sorry for myself at this juncture. And I'm sitting there, and now they are doing slant lines. And Miss Mino is up on the board, and she says, now, the slant lines go this way. 45 degrees, up, but make your elbows swing. You go back and forth, swing. Slant lines. So I grab my red pen, which they had given us. I grab my red pen, and I'm making slant lines like a fiend. I'm going, boy, this is good, you know. Already I was showing signs of a basic talent in slant line making. I'm making a slant lines. And then that talon on my shoulder again. I told you to use your right hand. I put my pen in my right hand, and I'm trying to make slant lines. Doing! The first drop of blood. Doing! Doing! Miss Mino, we'll have to take you back to the nurse's office. Your nose is bleeding again, Jean. The entire class looks. Doing! Doing! I am being led now down the hall. Miss Mino's talons have me by the back of the neck. 5 minutes later, I am returning to the classroom, and we are now on geography, and I'm home free. Till the next day. You see, you can only put off trouble in this world just so long. Nobody escapes it. Nobody is able to evade it. A lot of people are able to blow their kazoo loud enough, or do you prefer loudly enough? Yes, and go skipping through the great fields of waving grain with the sun beating down on their addled pates. They can do this long enough to pretend and get to actually believe that trouble is something that other people have. Don, will you please look on my record over there? Will you please look on my record? Just look, look. Don't start it. Just look on my record and see if you can find under the shade of the old apple tree, yes, you've got it. Can you set it up there for me? All right, you find it there and you just lay it in there, and when it's ready, you let me know. Because I think this attitude permeates much of our lives. And so now I have forgotten slant lines and ovals overnight. And I am deep in the heart of geography land, and I'm loving it because I was very good on geography. The first thing I remember Miss Mino starting us out to make was a relief map. And I like the name relief map. Wouldn't you like to have a map that takes you nothing but to pure relief? A map of relief. All right, bring it up there, Don. Here is man flittering through the world. Bring it up all the way. Oh, Like a death of a bird, I fly higher and higher, sun-kissed, laying leapfrog and tag with the fluffy white clouds. All together now. Let's go, gang. All right, that's enough. That's enough. We have just given you a taste, a little soupçon of euphoria. Just a little sip of the birds and the bees and the butterflies and the shade of the old apple tree. Yeah, okay, you got a scene there. Well, all right now. You want to continue the saga of Miss Mino and the left-handed oval maker, huh? Well, all right. The next day I arrive in class, and I've, you know, the euphoria is there. It's been the first or second, third days, and feeling fine. And finally, along comes about 2 o'clock in the afternoon. Miss Mino announces it is now once again time for writing, which is what they call just writing. They call it writing. Well, it consisted, as I have pointed out, of making ovals, and it consisted also of making slant lines. And so Miss Mino passes out the pens, those little red pens, you know, with the knobs on them that they use in school with the long, skinny points, borrowed from the post office department. And she passes these things out, and it starts. I am conscious now. Right hand. I've got to use this right hand. And I didn't even know there were two hands before. There were just two little meat hooks sticking out in front of me. I didn't know there was a right one or a left one. I didn't know that somehow there is an unfortunate connotation to the word left. And somehow there is a good connotation to the word right. That the term left and right has persisted throughout my life in one way or another. Have you noticed how the word left always means bad? The word right always somehow means good? That a right-handed hitter somehow seems to most people to be a more reliable hitter? That a left-handed pitcher is always considered a screwball and a nut, merely because he, as they say in the ineffable cliche way of the sports writer, he twirls from the port side? He's a nut, see? Well, I didn't know these things. So here I am. Miss Mino is setting me straight. Well, I can only say that after about a week, I had forgotten all about the fact that I ever did make an oval or a slant line with my left hand. Ever. I occasionally had a bloody nose. Yes, that is quite true. Occasionally, when I would be writing J-E with my right hand. With the big A, you know how kids make a big A. When I am about to make the cross of the eight, boing, boing, it would land on the paper there. The N, boing, would come down. Well, that persisted for a while. Even now, I can taste a little blood when I think about it. Oh, sure you do. You get to, an old bloody nose haver knows about these things. He knows blood early in his life. And I'll say this. That a person who's had bloody noses when he was a kid never is afraid of blood from that day on. Never. I say that every kid should be given a couple of swift belts in the nose at about the age of 3 and up to about 6 so he sees plenty of gore flowing, his own. And by the time he has seen this, he's no longer afraid of it. Oh, no, I don't, you know, when they take blood out of me for blood tests now, I don't quail chicken. I always heard about these guys fainting, you know, every time they get in the line in the army, getting the shots. Nothing. That's old story for me. Boing! I'd be writing J. Boing! It would go down. I just feel it. And you get so that you can feel it, a little tickling in the nose. And oh, here it comes. Boink! Before you go. Oh. Oh, man. You know, oh, boy. Here we go again. Humiliationsville. And you're down in the John. And guys are putting a wadded up
paper towels with water on them on the back of your neck. And you get so you're very good at it, you know. I got so I'd stick clothespin up there, boom, like that, up one nostril, clothespin, up the other one. I'd look out. Yeah, oh, yeah, there's all kinds of little bits with the nickel under the lip, all kinds of ways to do this. But the basic fact was that you tasted your own blood, and you tasted a lot of it. And so by the end of the week, I am already being slowly converted. Little realizing, of course, that Miss Mino and me, the two of us together, are producing that rare grade, that rare creature called ambidextrous. Producing this thing literally by design. Again, Miss Mino was thinking she was producing a right-handed person. Yeah, a left-handed person that is born left-handed never becomes right-handed. Wholly. Ever. A person who is born right-handed never becomes left-handed wholly. But if you get them early enough, you know what you can do? You can produce a kid who can do wild things with both hands. And it looks like magic to other people. It really does. And so here I am now, today, even to this day, I'm continually having strange, oh yes, ambidextrous people are excellent golfers, very good golfers. Do you know that when I first went out to play golf, and I never really pursued this game, but the very first day that I arrived out there, I was a caddy, Don, and I caddied for a while, and then, you know how you do, you eventually wind up playing. And so after a couple of weeks of watching guys hit golf balls, I never could understand why they had so much trouble with it. I really couldn't, you know, it seemed a perfectly simple thing to me. And so the very first day, I'm out there with Schwartz, and we're caddies, and a couple of guys went into the clubhouse to have a drink or something, and I said, wait out here. So I pulled his club out of the bag, and I teed up, and I stood there in front of it, addressed the ball, as they call it now, and it just stood there, you know, and I looked down the fairway, and I remembered all the guys that I had seen hit golf balls, and I brought that club back, and I... And, you know, natural. You know, I just laid it right down the center of the fairway, about 230 yards, and I teed up again. Down it goes. Well, Schwartz stood there with his mouth hanging open. And Schwartz said, wow. And I said, well, go ahead, try one, Schwartz. Schwartz put... He hits this little squirrel. Bounces. He hits another one straight up in the air. Then he hits one that goes... comes back again, makes three complete circles around us, and then sails off into the woods. You can hear them through the trees. I said, no, Schwartz, what you got to do is hit it straight, see? You do it like this. Now watch. Hit it straight. You're supposed to hit it that way. Hit it straight down there. See? To me, it was very simple. I tee up again. See the flag down there, Schwartz? Hit it towards the flag. That's all. Hit it towards the flag. So he says, okay. And he's standing up there, and you can see the sweat pouring down off his face. You know, he looks down at the flag. He goes, the ball bounces twice, hits a rock, cracks him on the shin, bounces up and hits him on the chin, and down he goes. I said, Schwartz, no. Don't hit it towards the rock. Hit it towards the flag down there. See where the flag is. Don't you see the flag down there? It's at number two. Hit it down there. Well, little realizing that Miss Mino was responsible for this phenomenon. You're right, Don, it does. And so here I am. at the age of nine, they have in our local neighborhood there, they have a tennis court. And so I am out there with my tennis racket, which I received as a gift from my Aunt Min. You know, nobody had ever had a tennis racket in my family. And Aunt Min gave me a tennis racket one Christmas, so I got a tennis racket. So I take the tennis racket, and I go out there, and I start playing tennis. You know, there's a bunch of kids out there. I hit the ball with right hand. The ball will come back. It's going over on my left side. I transferred quickly to my left hand. Pow! I hit it with my left. And, I can hit both ends like that. You know, anything. Just give me the tennis racket. I hit it wherever it comes. So I have no such thing as a backhand. All I have is forehands, you know. All I pow, hit it left-handed, pow, right-handed, pow, left-handed, pow, right-handed. I got real power. Then when I serve, I throw the ball up in the air, and I have a two-handed serve. Up the ball goes, boom, the pew, it goes whistling down there. And then immediately from the other end of the court, I hear, hey, that's no fair.
You got to use one hand. So I thought, okay, one hand. Little realizing that I was a budding Pancho Segura with a two-handed serve, you know. Well, so today this persists. I find myself seated in esoteric restaurants, and I pick up my fork, and somebody says, I didn't know you were left-handed. I said, I'm not. The next day, I sit down in the same restaurant. I pick up my fork, and somebody says, hey, I thought you were left-handed. I said, no, I'm not. And so, eventually, you get so that you assume a phony identity, the ambidextrous. He says to people, well, I'm right-handed. That makes people feel better, you see. Or you say, well, yes, I'm left-handed. That makes them feel better, too. That assures them. Now they know why you're a nut. You're left-handed. But if you say to them, well, actually, I'm not right-handed, and I'm not left-handed. I'm ambidextrous. And then as you say that, boing, a little drop of blood comes out of your nose. Boing. Just keep your news going, your knees loose, and keep your glove oil.
This is WOR Radio, your station.